battle. You see my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see a mountain moved. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe. There's nothing impossible for you.
Heart was worth I'm not afraid to die. Savior's God, victorious. My chains are gone, my debt is paid. From death to life, and grace to grace.
To FCC Online. We love connecting with you at our pre-service digital foyer, and we can't wait to get into worship. But before that, we want you to know that if at any time you have a prayer request, you can find a request prayer button at the bottom of the page. Click on it, fill in all your details and prayer requests, and this should send an email to our pastoral team. Once they receive it, they'll reach out to you as soon as possible. And across the week, if you need all the latest happenings and updates in church, you can find all the links here on our church online platform as well. All you gotta do is click on to past sermons to watch all the previous services and click on to resources for the sermon outlines, notes, and sell materials of our latest series. On Wednesdays, click onto Prayer and it will lead you straight to prayer meeting on Zoom, or click onto Student if you need the link to youth service on Saturday. For Kids Church, click onto Kids and you're good to go. Speaking of Kids Church, it happens every Sunday at 12 p.m. for kids aged 12 and below. There'll be Bible lessons, craft, and a really good family time together. So if you know anyone with kids, invite them over. That's all for now. And we know you're super excited for the service. So let's get right into worship.
Good morning, church. Psalm 73 verses 25 to 26 says, "Whom have I in heaven but you? And there is nothing on earth that I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever." Amen. Indeed, it's such a privilege that all we have and all we need is Christ. And God Himself is the strength of our heart, and He's our portion. So let's declare these truths as we sing together.
No.
For you are good and you are worthy, Lord. And all we have is you, all we have is Christ. Thank you, God, for saving us.
Christ,
of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer. There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. For my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can say all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken. For by my side, the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need, His power is displayed. To this I hold, Shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley He will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ in me. No fate I dread, I know I am forgiven. The future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my need. Oh, the chains are released. I can sing, I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me. For He has said that He will bring me home. And day by day, I know He will renew me. Until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to Him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
To this I hold,
to this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to Him.
Not I, but through Christ in me.
Welcome to our next segment of FCC Online Celebration, that is our giving. You know, when we give back a portion of what God has blessed us with, we are actually expressing our trust in Him, believing that He will provide our every need. In Proverbs 11:25, it reads, "The generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters will also be watered himself." Let us this morning give generously and cheerfully into God's kingdom, and in return, receive His blessings, receive God's mercy, and receive God's steadfast love. Let us pray. Father, we thank You that we have the ability, God, to give. Lord, as we give a portion of what You have blessed us with, Lord, we just ask, God, that You will greatly be honored, O God, and be pleased with our offering. And Father, as we give this offering, Lord, we want to tell You that we love You, we honor You, and we are so thankful for the ability, the opportunity that we can sow into Your kingdom. And Father, we pray that You will bless every sower, every giver, and You will use the offering for the furtherance of Thy kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And as usual, since we are still not back in church, you can put the offering into the envelope, okay, and then accumulate it, and at the end of the month, just bank the offering into the bank account, or we can do a more Chang way, that is to put into the e-wallet, okay, the touch and go e-wallet. So be blessed with the rest of the service.
I'd like to talk about, all right, steps into our destiny, all right? Steps into our destiny. And so if you have your Bibles, please turn to the book of Esther, all right? The book of Esther, chapter 4, verse 12 through verse 16. All my scriptures will be taken from the NIV version, okay? Esther chapter 4 verse 12 to verse 16, stepping into your destiny. Let's read together. Follow to, if you have your Bibles, just follow as I read, all right, this passage from Esther chapter 4 verse 12 to verse 16. When Esther's words were reported to Mordecai, he sent back this answer: "Do not think that because you are in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. But you and your families, your father's family, will perish. And who knows but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this." Then Esther sent this reply to Mordecai, and she said, "Go gather together all the Jews who are in Susa, and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my attendants will fast as you do. When this is done, I will go to the king, even though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish." Father, we thank You for Your word. Your word is everlasting, and Your word is ever relevant to us. And this morning, Lord, I pray that even as Your word is shared, that You will anoint, Lord, Your servant. You will anoint each one of us that hears Your word. And Lord, You will anoint, Lord, each one of us, dear God, that we would be able to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit, dear God. Thank You for being here. Lord, You are here not by proxy. You are here not virtually, but You are here in reality. We thank You, God. Your word tells us that when we gather in the name of Jesus in Your house particularly, Lord, You are here. And this morning, we thank You, God, that You are here, Lord, because, Lord, we welcome You. And we thank You, God, that as You are here, You're working in our lives. You are speaking into our lives. Lord, You are touching our lives. We thank You, God, that You are a God who is real, a God who is ever present today. And Lord, even as we turn to Your word right now, bless Your word, oh God. Lord, anoint your word, O God. Let your word, Father, come forth, Lord, as the oracle of God. I pray that you will speak, Lord, into our hearts. And we are careful, Lord, to give you all the glory and all the praise. In Jesus' name we ask and pray. Amen and amen. Praise God. Stepping into your destiny. Let me give you the context of the book of Esther first and foremost. In history, all right, Esther, you know, relates to us a time where Israel was under the dominion of the Persian Empire ruled by King Xerxes. Okay, you have to correct, you have to pronounce it right, okay? It sounds like a name, you know, in an anime game, all right? Xerxes, okay? All right? Israel was under the dominion of this Persian Empire, all right, ruled by King Xerxes, okay? And so many Israelites were exiled to the Persian capital of Susa. Now, among those who were exiled to Susa was Mordecai and his adopted daughter, Esther. By divine providence, okay, Esther was crowned queen of Persia. Now, during that time, right, a man called Haman arose to threaten the people of God. He was considered the most powerful man in Persia next to King Xerxes. Because Mordecai refused to bow down to Haman, Haman was enraged and he vowed that he would destroy Mordecai and all of God's people. Thus, you know, under the pretext, you know, of the Israelites being disloyal and treacherous, he induced King Xerxes, right, to pass an edict to have all the Israelites killed. Now, Esther was urged by Mordecai, right, to come before King Xerxes, right, to plead on behalf of the people. She hesitated because according to Persian law, no one is allowed to go before the king of Persia unless they are summoned. And if they do so, they are liable to be executed there and then unless, right, the king, right, gave instant pardon. In spite of her hesitancy, right, the Bible tells us that Esther nevertheless, right, called for the Jews to go on a three-day fast for her. And after that, she went to see the king. Now, to cut the story short, as God wills, okay, as God wills, Esther found favor with the king and had the situation reversed. Haman, right, and all his 10 sons were executed, and God's people found favor and prospered. That is, in essence, what the book of Esther is all about. The story behind Esther is all about. It tells us, right, that one man consecrated to God can make a difference to many. Let me repeat that. One man consecrated to God can make a difference to many. They can make a difference in history. That word consecrated, if you hear this, you know, in books, if you read this in books, if you hear this over the pulpit, it means to be sold out to God. It means to be sold out to something, to a cause, or to somebody. And in this instance, it tells us that one man, and it can be you and me, if we were to be sold out to God, if we were to be consecrated to God, we can make a difference to many, to a nation in history. You and I can make a difference. That is what God is telling us this morning. Even in this pandemic that we are in, even in this COVID-19 scare that we are in, you and I can still make a difference among many in our nation and even in history. And God is speaking to you here. God is speaking to you at home, that in spite of the environment that we are faced with, you and I can make a difference to many around us. Of course, you know, the book of Esther tells us that it is therefore important for us to learn two very important lessons. In order to make an impact to many, in order to make an impact to our nation and history, friends, we must learn these two very important lessons we can glean, right, from the person of Esther. And this is what I believe that God is speaking to us this morning. Firstly, It is important for us to understand, to remember that God has positioned us strategically, all right, in this time to fulfill His purpose. God wants to use you and I, regardless of the environment, regardless, you know, of how the situation around us is. God wants to use you and I, to make an impact upon our families, upon our community, upon our nation. For He has strategically, all right, placed us, all right, at this time to fulfill His purpose. The nation of Israel faced certain annihilation, but God had placed Esther strategically in the palace. What this tells us is this, friends, that regardless of the situation we find ourselves in, regardless of how precarious, unusual the situation you and I find ourselves in, we need to believe that God has a plan and He's working out His will in our lives and through our lives. We need to remember that. We need to be convinced. We need to be sold out to the fact that regardless of the situation we find ourselves in, God is still working out His plan and His will through our lives. For Ephesians chapter 2 verse 10, it reads this way: "For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." We are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. This verse tells us that God, all right, has a mission for you and I. God has, you know, a purpose for you and I. Friends, the moment we were born, the moment He breathed life into us, the moment we came to the Lord Jesus as making our Lord and Savior, God has a mission for us. God has an assignment for us, and it does not change in spite of the situation we find ourselves in. Right now, friends, we need to believe that right now that you are in God's place and in God's time to fulfill His purpose. How many believe that? In this time, all right, you are in God's place and in God's time right now, for God has an assignment for you. And you need to understand this, friends. You need to understand this, that you and I are people of destiny. God has, you know, placed an assignment upon our lives, a mission upon our lives. And right now, in this time and in this place, He is fulfilling out His purposes for our lives. Everything that has happened to you, right, to fulfill His purpose. Let me repeat that. Everything that is happening to you today is happening to fulfill His purpose. Everything that has happened to you, all right, in recent past has happened because God has a purpose for your life. God has a plan for your life. You need to be convinced of that. Nothing happens outside the realm of His purpose. Let me repeat that. Nothing happens, all right, outside the realm of His purpose. That's why you and I believe in Romans chapter 8 verse 28. Is that not right? For God works all things together for good, right? Because we love Him and we are called according to His purpose. What that means, you know, is that everything, nothing happens, and everything happens, it happens not outside the realm of His purpose. It happens within the realm of His purpose. Nothing catches God by surprise. Who is to know that Esther, when she was taken captive into Susa, would become the queen of Persia? Who is to know that when she became the queen of Persia, that God has designated and designed for her to be the savior of Israel? No one knows. No one knows that she will become, you know, from an exile, a captive. Exile captive, she would become a queen. And from being a queen, she would become the savior, quote unquote, of Israel. So, friends, you and I need to understand that nothing happens outside the realm of God's purpose. Amen. You are in God's purpose. God has an assignment for you. Right now, at this time, in this place, right? God is working out His purposes in and through your lives. And nothing can hinder or stop the plans of God. Isaiah reads this way. Isaiah 14 verse 27 tells us, "For the Lord Almighty has purpose, and who can thwart Him?" In a Hebrew, it reads, it can also read, "Who can hinder Him? Who can obstruct God? Who can frustrate God?" What God has purpose, friends, for your life and through your life, friends, who can thwart it? Who can obstruct it? Who can hinder it? Who can frustrate it? Not man, not the devil, not circumstances can thwart the plans of God. And he goes on to say, His hand is stretched out, and who can turn it back? And you and I must be convinced of that, all right? That God has strategically, all right, positioned you in such a time as this to fulfill His purpose. Even in this pandemic, even in this, you know, epidemic of COVID-19, God's purpose still goes on. 6 months ago, I think it was about six months ago, I testified that beyond my imagination, my father came to know the Lord. I mean, if you have been a Christian as long as I have been, and if you have served God as long as I have served God, you wonder if it's true or not that the book of Acts says you and your household shall be saved. You know, my father was about 90 plus years old. My mother is about 80 plus years old. You know, they have lived so long and I've served God for so long. And you wonder whether God will fulfill His purpose or not. Otherwise, you have to make an excuse for Him. Right? But 6 months ago, by the grace of God, right, by the mercies of God, my father gave his life over to the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. And I testified about it even in church, and you have heard about it. But how many of you know, all right, that in this pandemic, God is still working? Amen. 3 weeks ago, I'm glad to announce to you that my mother said the sinner's prayer. Amen. You know, I brought, you know, Brother Eddie Young to my house to minister and to pray for my father, all right? And, you know, in the course of that conversation, that ministry, you know, he persuaded my mom and, you know, he spoke to my mom, and my mom, you know, willingly prayed the sinner's prayer, you know, and after that, she even helped to pray for my father. You know, can you imagine that? And so there was great rejoicing. Of course, she's still an infant in the faith, but there is great rejoicing. And you know what God spoke to my heart? And I want you to hear very carefully what God is speaking to you and I today, church. And that is this, friends. God is greater than the C-19. He is working even in this pandemic. That's what God spoke to me. He is greater than this virus, you know, this tiny little virus that you cannot even see. And He is working even in this pandemic. Somebody say amen. And it came so strongly to me. And I said, God, yes, yes, I hear you. I hear you. And God, I hear what you're saying to your church. That God, that in spite of how difficult the situation is, in spite of what people say about this pandemic, you are greater. You are greater than this COVID-19. You are working even in this pandemic. God is not locked down. 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 8 and verse 9. Please flash it on the screen, please. It reads this, "Remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descended from David, as proclaimed by my gospel, for which I suffer to the extent of being chained like a criminal, but the word of God cannot be chained." The Apostle Paul was writing, was near to the end of his life, and he was writing from a prison cell in Rome. And Apostle Paul, in writing this letter, was encouraging his spiritual son, Timothy. And Paul said to Timothy, Paul was trying to encourage Timothy to rise up in faith, to rise up, you know, to be the man of God God called him to be. And in this verse, Paul was saying, Timothy, rise up and be strong. Remember Jesus Christ. Though he died, the tomb could not hold him. He was raised from the dead. Timothy, though I am in chains because of the gospel, the apostle said, the word of God cannot be chained. And that is the context of this verse. What Paul is saying to you and I is this. Friends, we need to rise up. You and I need to rise up in faith. Though we may be chained, though we face, you know, restrictions, friends, but God is not restricted. God is not locked down. The word of God is not chained. This is the word of God to you, church, today. Whatever you and I may be facing, no matter, you know, what regulations we are under, friends, we may find ourselves restricted because of age, because of health, because of finance, because of various other things. But friends, God is not locked down. God's word is not chained. His ministry is not chained. His spirit is not chained. He is still moving. Amen. Hallelujah. Do not lock God down with a fearful mind. Hello. Do not lock God down with a fearful mind. Christians, you are supposed to keep walking in faith in spite of the circumstances. Amen. You are the believer of the Most High God. Somebody say amen. You are a believer of the Most High God. Somebody say amen. Hallelujah. You are not like those who do not know God. You are not like those outside who do not know God. Friends, the darker the night, the brighter you should be shining. Because you have God on your side. You are not locked down by your circumstances. God is not affected by whatever happens around us. He is still working. You and I, friends, need to remember that. We are not like those outside who does not have hope. The darker the night, the brighter you shine. The more bleak the situation. In fact, you will be a brighter testimony. You should be a brighter testimony. Your life of faith and confidence, friends, should attract people to God. They should attract people to the good news of Jesus Christ. They will want to hear, what is it that you have that in spite of the bleak situation, you are still walking with confidence and with peace in your heart? The darker the night, friends, the brighter the light should shine. You and I should be a greater testimony. Our light should be brighter in the midst of a bleak circumstance. Amen. I don't care so much what the scientists say. I don't care so much about what the economists say, friends. You are all very high risk. Let me repeat that. You are all very high risk to be infected by the blessings of God. Amen. I declare this over you. You know, I felt very sad during this pandemic. Because why? Unconsciously, subconsciously, all right? Yes, we have all the regulations. We have all the regulations that's so necessary to be put in place during this pandemic. But what happens is subconsciously, when it is declared, when the health ministry declares something, you know, give you a title, categorize you at the title, your faith is also locked down. You forget people of God, forget that they are people who believes in the great and the Most High God. They forget that they are candidates, very likely candidates to be infected by the blessings of God. Did not Psalm 23 say that? For surely mercies and goodness will follow you. Not the C19, huh? Surely goodness and mercy of God will infect you. Can I put it that way? Count your blessings. Name them one by one. All right, go home and write down. C19 means, all right, counting my 19 blessings. All right, Write down all the blessings that God has promised you. So that's why I say I don't care, really care what the scientists, the economists are saying. I'm not saying I don't care. I really don't care. I mean to say that I don't care so much. Why? Because God's word, God's truth tells me that I'm a very high-risk candidate to be blessed by God. And so are you. And Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20, please. It says what? That God, to the God who's able to do immeasurably more, immeasurably more than what I think, ask, or imagine of, to Him be the glory forever and ever. God is able to do more than what you think, more than what you ask, more than what you imagine. This is the promise of God. Have you forgotten Ephesians 3:20? Well, please write it down in the Bible. God, the God you worship, the God you trust, is able to do more, immeasurably, abundantly, exceedingly abundantly, more than what you think, ask, or imagine. That's the God you worship. That's the God you believe in. Hallelujah. So I believe the first lesson we need to learn from Esther's life is that we need to remember that God, all right, has strategically positioned you at this time to fulfill His purpose, regardless of the circumstances, regardless of the environment you find yourself in. Number two, I believe that in order, right, to make an impact to others in the times that we're living in order to fulfill the great purposes of God, it must be required that we are willing to take steps of faith. Or in other words, to put it very simply, risk. In order for you and I to fulfill, all right, the purposes of God, it requires us to be willing to take steps of faith, to take risks. The life of faith is a life of risk. You see, Esther was designated queen. She was destined to be the savior, all right, of an entire race. And you know what is the only thing that could have kept her from that destiny, from fulfilling God's destiny and purpose for her life? The only thing that could have kept her from fulfilling God's purpose and destiny, if she had allowed fear, all right, to lock her down, and she refused to come before the king to plead on behalf of the people of Israel. Yes, fear. That's the only thing that could have kept her from fulfilling her destiny and God's purposes, right, for her life and through her life. And friends, may I suggest to you this morning, God has a wonderful purpose for your life. God has wonderful plans for your life. God has a wonderful destiny for your life. And He has not changed in spite of the situation you find yourself in today. And the only thing that could keep you from God's plans and purpose and destiny for your life, friends, if you allow fear to grip your heart and you refuse to do what God wants you to do, you refuse to take the step of faith and risk trusting God's word. Many are a step away from the blessings of God. One day, I was just hearing this clip from somewhere, somebody speaking, and it just struck me. It struck me just like that. Because the man of God was saying, many are just a step away from the blessing of God. Many are just a step away from experiencing the mighty works of God. Many are just a step away from the reality of His power and His presence. If only, friends, they would take the step of faith and risk trusting God's word. What it's saying is this. Many of us fail to enter into the promised land. Many of us failed to enter into the blessings of God. Many of us failed to experience God in a greater way, to experience a breakthrough that you're clamoring for. Because why? Because we refuse to take the step of faith and risk trusting God's word. Faith is an act. Write it down. Faith is an act. It's not a wish. It's not a hope. But faith is an act. And often it goes against the natural understanding. Many times faith goes against the natural ways of doing things. Why? Because faith takes risks. That's right. Faith is an act and it takes risks, friends. Many miss out on the blessing because they dare not give. Many miss out on salvation because the salvation of their loved ones, because they dare not open their mouth and testify. Many miss out, on the miracle, the supernatural power and the presence of God. Why? Because they refuse to step out of their boats. Faith is an act. It takes risks, friends. In Matthew 14:22, this is a story in which Jesus instructed his disciples to cross the Sea of Galilee in a boat while he stayed on the shore to pray. And as the disciples were in the boat crossing over the Sea of Galilee, Jesus saw that, strong winds were buffeting against the boat. And Jesus decided to walk towards the boat, towards his disciples, to see how they were doing. And when the disciples saw Jesus walking towards the boat, they thought it was a ghost. They were afraid and they cried, "It is a ghost, it is a ghost." But Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid, be courageous, it is me." And Peter, hearing Jesus' words, said, Lord, if it is you, can you please tell me to come to you? And Jesus said, "Come, come." And so Peter got out of the boat, all right, and he found himself walking towards Jesus. But halfway, he felt the winds. He saw, all right, the waves that was hitting against him. And he got afraid, and doubt came into his mind, into his heart. And, he began to sing. Jesus had to grab him and help him onto the boat. All of us know this story. Let me ask you some very important questions. Would Peter have walked on water if he did not step out of the boat? No, isn't it? If Peter did not step out of the boat, if Peter did not take the risk, of stepping out in faith and take the risk of obeying Jesus' words, friends, he would not have walked on water. Now let me ask you another question, a very important, basic question. When Peter stepped out of the boat, right, what was he standing on? What was he standing on? He was standing on water, wasn't it? He was walking on water. Out of the boat, there is water around him. But what was it? I think you are very smart people. You know what the answer. You know what was holding Peter up? You know what was working that miracle in his life? Friends, when he stepped out of the boat, it wasn't the water that was holding him afloat, friends. It was the Word of God that was holding him up. And that's how faith works, friends. Faith is an act. When you act on God's word, when you are willing to take the risk and step on God's word and walk, obey God's word, friends. The Word of God, which is yea and amen, the Word of God, which never changes, friends, will hold you up in the supernatural. And that's how it works, friends. It wasn't the water, that helped Peter up, but it was the word spoken by Jesus that said, "Come," that helped Peter up. Faith is an act. It takes risks. And until you act on the Word of God, and until you risk acting on the Word of God, you will not go further in the walk of faith. The question is, what is God telling you to do today? It may be unreasonable. It may seem foolish. It may seem like a lot. But what is God telling you to do if you will only obey and take the risk? Miracle will take place in your life. So faith is taking the risk of trusting God's word and stepping out of your boat. I hope I can finish this. You see, I walk with God. A lot of times is faced with a lot of storms. Our service for God, a lot of times, our assignments that's beyond our ability. And really, right, our walk and our service to God requires God's grace, God's enablement. Therefore, it requires us to be dependent on God. And do you know that's the reason why Esther called for a 3-day fast before she went to see the king? Because she realized this statement that was spoken by a well-known speaker, a man of God. Okay. And the man of God says, God's work has to be done His way with His power. Esther realized when God assigned her, you know, that assignment to go before the king, it must be done according to God's way and God's power. And that is why she asked for prayer and fasting. Anything that we do, the journey that we take in this life with God, must be girded with prayer and even fasting. We cannot do it with our own strength. What, how great the idea is, how great the plan is, how great the project is, friends. The most important question, you know, we must ask, God, is if this is from you, you must enable me. I need your power. Even today, right, the whole week, before I preach the word of God, before I present the word of God, we would pray and fast. Why? Because it's not just presenting a word. The word must be presented by the power of God, anointed by prayer. Esther called for a 3-day fast because she realized that she better meet the King of Kings before she meets the King. Hello? If you want to do something great for God, you want to live your life that has significance to others, then you must meet the King of Kings first before you meet anybody else. It doesn't mean that you meet the King that you haven't made. No. You may have an appointment to meet the King, but you need to meet the King of Kings before you meet the King. And that's what Esther learned. That's what Esther realized. And she said, God, if I perish, I perish. When we commit to God's purpose and trusting His word, God will use us to impact lives and history. Esther said, if I perish, I perish. Now let me close with this. Just a couple of thoughts. You and I can make a difference. We must remember that God has placed us in specific positions to fulfill His purpose. In order to make that difference, we must be willing to take the risk in trusting His word. In other words, we must live and walk in faith and take that risk for God. Esther 4:14, could you please project it on the screen, please? These were the words of Mordecai to Esther when she hesitated to go before the king. She said, for if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. But you and your father's family will perish. And who knows but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this? And who knows but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this? In essence, this is what Mordecai said to Esther. Mordecai said, Esther, if you refuse to obey and step out in faith and face and approach the king, God will raise another person to accomplish His will. Esther, if you refuse to take that step of faith and obedience, God will raise up another person to accomplish His will. Number two, Mordecai said to Esther, Esther, if you refuse to obey and step out in faith and take the risk, that fear of destruction that has come into your heart will overtake you and your family. Number three, Mordecai said to Esther, Esther, if you refuse to obey and approach the king, you will miss out on God's purpose and the blessings that comes with it. That was what Mordecai said to Esther. And these are the words that God is saying to us. Friends, you and I can be used of God if we remember that God has strategically put us in positions to influence and to fulfill His will. If we are willing, all right, to take steps of faith and even risk. What is God positioning you to do today? What is God telling you to do today? May I encourage you this morning to trust God, all right, and step out of your boat. Take that risk. Take that risk, friends. Your safety, your provision, your blessing, and your breakthrough is in that step of faith. When you step out of your boat and you dare to take the risk because God has said it, friends, your protection, your blessing, right? Your breakthrough will come. Many of us are stuck because we refuse to take that step. And this morning, God is telling you He has a plan and a purpose for your life. Would you believe Him? Would you take the risk by obeying His word? That is what God is saying. Church, God is still working. I said God is still working. Amen. He is still great God. And we are believers of this great God this morning. Amen. There's some of us here, you have been facing some stormy, uncertain times. And you're feeling restless. You don't know what is ahead. You're feeling restless. You're feeling fearful even. It may be because of this pandemic you are in. It may be because of other things. But you are facing a circumstances where you are not sure whether to turn to the right or to the left. You're so troubled and uncertain and restless. Perhaps God is telling you to do something. Telling you to do something. You don't understand what is happening. It is perplexing, it's precarious. You don't know. And you are afraid to step out. You are afraid to do that thing which you felt that is the right thing to do. This morning, God wants to minister to you, and God is speaking to you today. I'm just going to pray for you right now. Father, I want to pray that your word, Lord, would have touched many today. I believe that God and your word, Father, would have touched many lives today. Lord, there are those, Lord, who are facing uncertain times, stormy times, uncertain. Lord, they don't know what to do. They don't know what to make of it. I pray, Father, for peace and rest to be upon them. Lord, let them know that, God, you are working out your purposes for them. You have an assignment for them, even in the midst of that storm, uncertainty and rest, Lord, that they are facing. Lord, you are working out your purpose. I pray, Father, for that, knowing that confidence, Lord, of the Holy Spirit to come upon them. I pray, Father, for those, Lord, who are afraid, Lord, who are afraid to take the next step, Lord. Father, because, Lord, it is such a drastic step, uncertain step, Lord, I pray that in the name of Jesus that you will grant them courage. Courage, oh God, to believe your word and take that step of faith and risk trusting your word. I pray in the name of Jesus, Father, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would take your word and continue to speak to your people. Speak peace and rest into the hearts of your people. Lord, make clear your plans and your will for them, O God. And I pray that you will grant courage, that they will trust in you and your word. I pray your word will find a hiding place in our hearts today. I give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. When I see that cross, I see freedom. When I see that grave, I see Jesus. Confronted to love, I will sing your praise. In the world around.
from death to life, and grace to grace.